Good morning. Welcome to worship on this Christ the King Sunday, and welcome to those who are watching us at home and who will watch the YouTube later. There are a whole lot of announcements in the bulletin for you to pay attention to. There's not going to be a live Thanksgiving service. It's already been pre-recorded. It's being put together. A link will arrive in your email on Wednesday. You also want to note what it has to say about Christmas Eve and about poinsettias for Christmas. There's an announcement about the blessing bags, the need for stocking those to get things for those. Now also we have the fellowship forum after worship today. And this will also include an opportunity to address some cards, to write little notes to folks who haven't been able to be present here. So if you'd like to participate in that, that'll be set up during the fellowship hour. And it's time to turn in your names for the transition team. If you have not already done so, today is the day. There's a slips of paper and pens available if you don't have one. There's a basket by the offering plate back there. There'll be a box in the fireside room at the fellowship forum. Get your names in. And also, I have another announcement that I know will please a lot of folks. The council accepted the COVID team's recommendation to allow congregational singing. You must keep your mask on. We're continuing to observe all of the other COVID precautions of maintaining space between one another. When it's time to leave, this side goes out that door, this side can go out that door, or wait till everyone's gone out. All the good physical spacing, distancing that we've been doing, which also means that when in a moment I tell you to stand up and greet each other, you pivot to do it. No open hugging in the sanctuary at this point. Are there any other announcements that need to be made this morning that I missed? And stand up and greet each other. Let us begin our worship with the confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Have mercy on us, O God. We confess that we have sinned against you and against our neighbors. We have built walls instead of table. We have turned away the stranger. We have sought glory for ourselves. And we have treasured that which does not satisfy. Help us to love as you love, to welcome those you send, and to treasure mercy and justice. Turn us from our ways to your ways, and free us to serve those in need. Amen. God, who makes all things new, forgives your sins for Jesus' sake, and remembers them no more. Lift up your heads and your hearts. Yours is the kingdom of God.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, you anointed your beloved Son to be priest and sovereign forever. Grant that all the people of the earth, now divided by the power of sin, may be united by the glorious and gentle rule of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
The marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors in the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth has been suspended as the king comes through the gate. The king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The king is coming, the king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed. Broken homes he has mended, those from prison he set free. Little children and the aged, hand in hand, stand all aglow. Those who are crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow.
The king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The king is coming, the king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. I can hear the chariots rumble, I can see the marching throng, and the flurry of God's trumpet spells the end of sin and wrong. Eagle robes are now unfolding, heaven's grand stands all in place. Heaven's choir is now assembled, stars to sing. Sounding, and now his face I see. The king is coming, the king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Praise God, he's
first reading this morning is from the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 1, starting at verse 4b. Grace and peace to you from him who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, and even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty, the word of the Lord.
Please stand for the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel according to John, the 18th chapter. Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Creator and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Christ the King Sunday, one of the minor festivals in the church year. Now, we don't have kings in our country, although I have heard that at the beginning of the whole birth of our nation, there was some discussion that the chief administrative office should be called king. It would just be an elected king who had limitations. But George Washington said, no, can't have the title king. That's too messy. We're going to get rid of it. That didn't mean we got rid of political power. We know when we think the word king, we think of political power. We tend to think of power over others. Power to get things done. Power to have your own way. Now, in the Old Testament, the concept of a king, when the people of Israel said, "We want to be like everyone else, we want to have a king," and God said, "Bad idea." But the people said, but, God said, "Okay." But God's image of a king for the people of Israel would be someone who would look out for the interest of the people. The most common metaphor for a king in the Old Testament is to be a shepherd, and the shepherd takes care of the flock. That was what the kings were intended to be. Of course, that's not how it played out. It's very difficult to separate political power from exercising personal power and getting your own way. It's a challenge. So what really do we do with the idea of Christ the King? Jesus is not a king who exercises power over others in order to get his own way. Might be closer to say Jesus does more of a power with others. And when you speak of having power with others, that really means empowering those who have been disempowered. It means working for justice, for true equality. And certainly that is something God calls us all to do. But that really kind of makes the celebration of Christ the King seem even odder. Christ the King. It might surprise you to know that this festival of the church here is relatively new. It's been around for less than 100 years. Pope Pius XI initiated it in 1925. Might also surprise you to learn just why he added this festival to the church calendar. Pius was looking out at the world post-World War I, and he was concerned about the rise of nationalism, about the concept that each nation was in competition with other nations, that for a nation to get ahead, that would mean some other nation would have to fall behind. Nationalism is a way of looking at the world as though it's a zero-sum game. And if I gain something, that means you've lost. And Pius was looking at what was happening, and he said, "This is wrong. This is not what God calls us to do. God does not call us to be in competition with each other. We don't have individual kings, individual nations fighting each other. We have one King, Christ the King. We are to center on Christ and only Christ." And I think Pius was really wise to see the dangers of nationalism, because so often nationalism starts to slip over into not just our country is entitled to things, but our country is automatically the best at everything. Yeah, we might slip up sometimes, but we're the best. And that often slides into we're the best, and we have, you know, the primary religion that we have is the best, and all the traditions and customs that we do are the best. And pretty soon that means that everyone in the country needs to embrace that. And that's the description of fascism. Pius's attempt to establish Christ the King Sunday in order to be a response to nationalism didn't quite work. And that's a sobering thought to all of us. Christ the King, intended to remind us that Christ is ruler of all, and intended really to remind us that we are not in competition with each other, that we are called to community. In the gospel text, when Pilate is questioning Jesus, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus very quickly dispels any idea that he's any kind of political power. His kingdom is not from this world. It transcends this world. And Jesus says, "I came, I was born to testify to the truth." And Pilate then says, "What is truth?" Seems like it should be easy, right? Something is true or it's not. But life just isn't that easy. It is true that sunny days are wonderful. It's also true that if we never have any rain, we'd be in huge trouble. It is true that we are called to love and care for one another, to feed the hungry. But it's also true that only feeding them doesn't really address the concerns of why are there hungry people in the first place when this world produces abundant food? Why is there economic injustice? Why is there poverty? What is best? What is truth? We are called to love one another, to be in relationship with one another. But then when we actually set out to do it, it becomes challenging. We live in a world that is so full of challenges. It is hard to know what is truth, what is right, what is best. And we do struggle with that. We even struggle with things like the simple Ten Commandments. You shall not kill. But even when we know whose finger was on the gun, we don't really know how to deal with the aftermath. We had an example of that this week. In response to the Kyle Rittenhouse verdict, the presiding bishop of the ELCA issued a statement. Dear church, in the book of Leviticus we read, you shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. Our social message on community violence urges us to become more involved in countering the reality and fear of violence in our communities and our neighbors' communities, pursuing justice and seeking peace, no matter how long the journey or complex the challenge. When a child is allowed to become a vigilante without recourse, we are forced to confront the idols of our society: guns, violence, and white supremacy. To be sure, this is not about one person, but indeed about all of us together. Today's acquittal is an injustice. It points to the disorder in which we all live. As we seek to restore justice, so also will we restore God to God's rightful place at the center of our life together. In Christ, the Reverend Elizabeth A. Eaton. God's rightful place at the center of our lives together. The same thing Pius was trying to create when he established Christ the King Sunday. God at the center of our lives together. God calling us to love and care for one another. How would Christ have ruled in this trial? I don't think that's the right question. I think the questions are more profound than that. How do we address and repair the damage that is done by racism? How do we reach out to bring justice to those who are oppressed, to those who are in the margins? How do we restore our society so that it is a place where everyone can live and thrive in God's love? This is not about particular incidents and events. This is about how we live together. And that does flow from having God at the center of our lives, from hearing God's call, God's challenge to us to truly love one another, even those with whom we disagree. In the hymn that we are about to sing together, it talks about the day when Christ will come in glory. It talks about the time when we will see Christ face to face. But that time is already now. The kingdom of heaven is here. It is not yet completely fulfilled. If it was, we wouldn't have the challenges we have. And yet the kingdom of heaven is here. We see Christ face to face. We see Christ in the face of each other. We see Christ in the face of those with whom we disagree. We see Christ in the face of those who are in need. We see Christ in the face of those who are victims of violence. and we see Christ in the face of those who have caused violence. How do we move forward? How do we help one another to care for each other, including those children who have been taught that violence is an appropriate response to disagreements? We have challenges, and yet the kingdom of God is here. Christ is our King. Christ is with us. Into this mess of a world that we have, Christ is here with us. This is Christ the King Sunday, because the kingdom of heaven is here. And we are called to live fully into that kingdom, to recognize when we make mistakes, to seek God's grace and forgiveness, and to know that God's grace is with us, that God's love empowers us. We don't have all the answers, but we know the truth. The truth is God's love calling us to love each other. Amen. Stand, and together let us confess our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Each prayer petition will end with the phrase, God in your mercy. Please respond, hear our prayer. Eternal God, you hold firm amid the changes of this world. Hear us now as we pray for the church, the world, and everyone in need. God, you sent your Son, Jesus, to testify to the truth. We pray for preachers, evangelists, and teachers who carry your forgiveness and love to the world. Fill their words and actions with compassion and kindness so that your truth will shine. God, in your mercy. God, you sent your Son, Jesus, to liberate all of creation. We pray for all living things longing for freedom to flourish, from ancient trees and wild grasses to endangered animals and rare insects. Give human beings compassionate hearts to care for them. God, in your mercy. God, you sent your Son, Jesus, to lead us into the way of peace. Guide nations and peoples in their paths toward the future. Give leaders the humility and wisdom to make just decisions to benefit all. Bring peace to the turmoil that is present in Haiti. Protect our sister congregation, Les Anglais. Lord, in your mercy. God, you sent your Son, Jesus, to make us into your own people, set free to serve you. We pray for people who serve the well-being of others, especially ministries in our community. Give health and comfort to all in need. Today we name Barbara, Diane, Bob, those in need of food and shelter, those who will be alone on Thanksgiving, those who are traveling for the holidays, and those whom we now name out loud or in our hearts. God, in your mercy. God, you sent your Son, Jesus, to rule in all times and places. Be present in all congregations in time of transition. Give them courage and confidence to move, to more explore new possibilities for the future. Guide the members of this congregation as the transition team is formed. God, in your mercy. God, you sent your Son, Jesus, to be our beginning and our ending. We give thanks for those whose lives have given us a glimpse of Jesus' reign of justice and peace. Empower us to join their witness. God, in your mercy. God, our hope and strength, we entrust to you all for whom we pray. Remain with us always, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Although we do not pass the offering plate, it's time to reflect on how our offerings are part of our worship. And by the offering plates at the doors, at least by that one, there's, and in, I think in your pew pockets, chair pockets, there's Thanksgiving offering envelopes. So if you want to make a special Thanksgiving offering, that's an opportunity. You may be seated as we prepare for communion. I forgot the offering prayer. Let us pray the offering prayer. Holy God, the earth is yours and everything in it, yet you have chosen to dwell among your creatures. Come among us now in these gifts of bread and wine, and strengthen us to be your body for the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to have your bread and wine nearby, including those who are at home, to make sure it's nearby as I prepare the table. For those who are worshiping online, remember that you are indeed part of this body of Christ, and the same is true for those who will watch the video later. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, surrounded by evil and bordered by death, we appeal to you, our sovereign, our wisdom, and our judge. We praise you for Christ, who proclaimed your reign of peace and promised an end to injustice and harm. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Send your spirit on these gifts of bread and wine, and on all who share in the body and blood of your Son. Teach us your mercy and justice, and make all things new in Christ. Remembering our Lord's life, death, and resurrection, we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, I invite you to share the bread with someone who is sitting next to you. And for those who are sitting alone or at home alone, I invite you to take the bread with me. This is the body of Christ given for all of us. And I invite you to take the cup and share it with one another, with the words, "This is the blood of Christ shared for each of us." Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed Jesus, at this table you have been for us both host and meal. Now send us forth to extend our tables and to share your gifts until that day when all feast together at your heavenly banquet. Amen. This time we have our sending song. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.